Well, good evening. Welcome to the Christmas Eve service. I am not Andy. If you haven't figured that one out. So. But I am his uncle and my wife, Janelle. And Kevin's going to sit in here, too. We're going to do some Christmas songs. And need your help up here as we sing these songs. There's no band, so I want to hear all of you singing. I'll evaluate you on each section.
To the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their hearts employ for fields and floods, rocks, hills, and the plains. Repeat the sound of joy. Repeat the sound of joy. Repeat, repeat the sound in joy. Now He rules the world with truth and grace, and He makes the nations prove the glories of His righteousness and the wonders of His love, the wonders of His love, the wonders and wonders of His love, of His love. Come on, sing this part with me. I said, joy to the world. You're singing like you mean it now. Joy to the world.
One more time.
Joy to the world.
Amen.
Amen.
Doesn't Jesus bring joy to the world, especially during this time?
Yes.
We're going to sing another classic favorite here.
The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the sky. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. His heart the herald angels sing, Glory to the newborn King. Newborn King. Christ flies, heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold he come, offspring of the favored one. Veiled in flesh of Godhead's hailed in God's deity. Pleased a man with man to dwell. Jesus, our Emmanuel. His heart the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Newborn King now. Newborn King. Now hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings. Risen with healing in his wings. The smile he lays his glory by. Born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth. Born to give the second birth. His heart the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. He's a newborn King. He's a newborn King.
Amen. Okay, I might need some hand clapping on this next one here, okay? Born.
All he wants is a bonus.
Here we go.
'Cause I was a lonely seeker, I saw both night and day. I asked the Lord to help me, yeah, and he showed me that way. He made me a watchman up on the city wall.
Here we go.
And if I am a Christian, I am the least of all. That's so true. Now go tell it on the mountain, over the hills, and everywhere. Now go tell it on the mountains that Jesus Christ was born. That Jesus Christ was born. That Jesus Christ was born. Yeah. That Jesus Christ was born.
One more time.
That Jesus Christ was, he was born.
Yeah. Amen. Excellent job. Participating and clapping. Love it. Love it. Here we go, sing on.
angels hail, Lord, we greet thee, who's born this happy morning. Oh, Jesus, forevermore be thy name adored.
Word of the Father.
This word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore you. Oh, come, let us adore you.
Father, we just want to constantly adore you, and we just love you so much, Lord, and just so privileged to be here and just sing your praises and lift your name up. And God, thank you for this coming to this world in a manger, and also just in a such a humble way, God, that in a stable, God, that it's amazing that you could be anything you want to be, and you chose to come that humbly and to be born to save our souls, Lord. So I just pray for the message tonight, and I pray for the fellowship after. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Drag my family up here to do the final reading for this year. Are they awesome or what? So good. Some of the most profound truth in the world is right here in front of us. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. You think about a given Christ, given to you, given to me as an eternal once for all sacrifice. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to the public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to call him the name of Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name of Jesus.
Liturgy here, so it's like going to your thing. Here we go. I'm going to make a mess of this right here in front of everybody. Father in heaven, we do. We light candles. We do the little things maybe to symbolize the light that your son brought into the world. And God, I just pray tonight that we would all just step back in thorough adoration and respect and appreciation for what you've done to save us from our sins and sending your son to be our savior. Amen. Thank you. We'll have that. Unless you want to do the rest. No, point not. I'm going to talk her into it. I'll tell you another time about the first sermon I ever did. She preached it. That's the story right there. Anyway, I got something. That's not good, I'm sure. Something I want to share with you guys as we start our evening tonight. A friend of mine wrote this. He calls it Crash, that's me. I'm going to pull it together any minute now, I promise you. Christ's last night in heaven. I'm ready, Father. Son, the next thought you will have will be that of a baby's. All memories of this home, this glory, this beauty will be gone. They will be replaced with filth, cold, and pain. The first breath you take will pull you on a course to your death. It will take years before you'll remember this conversation, this arrangement. One day, parents holding your hand, you will pass a blind beggar calling out to God. You'll look back, suddenly knowing it is you he is calling to. Then it will dawn on you who you are, who I am, and where home is. That moment will be the loneliest of all, the morning you realize how far away you are from home. Then, finally then, it happens. The deepest magic moment, the single most important moment in the history of all the galaxies, in the dead of the night when the world will least suspect, in the depth of human history, with even the most devout had almost given up all hope, when evil had apparently finally been conceded victory. The world is at its darkest this hour before the first Christmas. Then, with only a mother's panting gasp and a newborn's cry, God suddenly enters into history to rescue us, not in thunder and smoke or even on a white horse, but in quiet, fragile helplessness. In a cold, dark corner of the world, God becomes not man, but first child. All the angels stand their post and hold their breath. And now we are not alone. He really did remember. God will now forever be with us. A fragile crying baby, not a grown man. So none of us could say that he doesn't understand our life. On earth, so no one could claim he didn't breathe our air. In the center of mankind, so no one could say he was above us. In humility, so no one would feel bullied by him with no protection. So no one would ever be able to say that he didn't feel alone. In common, desperate, impoverished surroundings. So no one would say he didn't feel want. Choosing to enter the human race of men and gradually learn who he was. With questions, with lack of understanding, the God of the universe taking on the form of a man to progressively learn to eat, to sleep, to thirst, to feel tiredness, both for you and for me. And he also came to feel and taste death for every one of us. Oh, this is well written. Really appreciate what he had to say there. What we're doing today is we're just appreciating Bethlehem. We're appreciating what happened on that absolute amazing night. Do we know when it was? We actually don't. It probably wasn't on December 25th. I guess there's a 1 in 365 chance that it was. But this is the year, this is the date of the year where we celebrate and where we recognize. And part of it is after centuries of strict religion with our Jewish friends, God had brought the human race to a point where they should really understand is that they cannot get to heaven through religion, through deeds, whether that be sacraments, promises, commitments, ritual, religious piety. I'm going to really do it. I'm going to impress him. I'm going to earn my way to heaven. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't alter what you are at your innermost person in and of yourselves to then become acceptable to him. You just can't. But you can trust him and you can believe in him. He knew we can't, so he did. We couldn't get to him, so he came to us. And that is what we're celebrating. Let's look at the narrative today out of Luke chapter 2. It says this, in those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own towns to register. So you probably understand what that is, right? Our Jewish friends had a very limited amount of freedom. They were occupied by Rome. Rome gives them the freedom so that they can go out and make a living and then give half of it to Rome. Perhaps some of us can begin to relate. They were free, but they were not free. So the governor says, you know, I want a head count. I want to know how much money, how much potential is there. So he issues a decree that everybody goes basically to their hometown to register. So Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting child. Just real quick before we move on, this is kind of a neat thing I like to do, but Joseph, we don't know a whole lot about him. We know he's a carpenter. I love that when God chose to send his son into the world. He picked a contractor, blue collar, and Joseph was probably poor, as we learn as we saw their sacrifice in the temple following the birth. But he wouldn't have gone by the name Joseph. So we tend to think Yosef, but it was probably more, Yosef would have been like Greek, but to really understand probably the Hebrew, his name would have been closer to Jacob, believe it or not, than it would have been to Joseph. And Mary actually wouldn't have responded to Mary. She might have turned her head, what? Her spoken name was Miriam. I don't know why we didn't just translate it Miriam. Well, I do, but I'll spend the whole time complaining about it if I try to explain it. The Bible was translated into Latin before it was translated into English, so they dropped the M. Maria. And then when it came to English, simply Mary. Her and Joseph would go on to have at least six other children. He did maintain the purity during her pregnancy, but, and you know what, as a pastor, sometimes you go, well, you know, saying things like that could really rock the boat. Well, let it rock. Because part of what you want to do here is teach the Bible, but also shepherd people. And sometimes that means shepherding understandings. And there are a few things that have gotten away from us, and that is one of them. But think, see, why would he take her? Why would he take her? It's a three-day journey. They didn't call Uber. Would have been a couple hours then. See, the thing is that if you are, and she was probably 14, 15, maybe as old as 17 years old, and you turn up pregnant, that's a real problem. Adultery carried a death penalty. Premarital relations did not in the Old Testament. But I don't know if they convinced anybody. They're just convinced. So it was Joseph's job to protect her from the religious piety that would judge her. It was extreme, and it was very, very poor. So she has no choice but to travel with him. And again, we like to picture the donkey and all that. And maybe we don't know. She may very well have walked, because when she got there, she went into labor. So it's possible. There you go. But they're expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And firstborn would indicate what? Yeah, exactly. Okay. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. See, as it turns out, she faced persecution in Nazareth, but when she gets there, she feels it too, especially if you understand the culture at the time. They didn't build hotels like we might expect. Oh, Motel 6 is packed, check Holiday Inn, no good there either. What are we gonna do? No, the word there in the Greek language also means a guest house. Now remember, they're of the line of David. This is his place. So there would have been cousins, aunts, uncles. For all we know, Elizabeth was there. We don't know who all was there. But then you begin to smell a rat. Because it wasn't individual rooms and all the rooms were filled. It probably would have been about the size of half of this area. And what you would do is you just go in and kind of pick a spot. And that's where you slept. So they wouldn't let a pregnant teenager in. Religious piety can really get you, can it? And it's just amazing that way she was treated. But you know what? It's not that they wouldn't let a pregnant teenager in. They wouldn't let a teenager who just went into labor. They wouldn't let her in. We're tough on sin here. Got to make sure we crush people with holiness. We don't do that here. We don't do that here. And if you attend here, please don't do that. That is not gracious or Christ-like whatsoever to think that somebody sins and they have the story wrong. And we never know the full story, do we? Why? Why does religion treat people that way ever so often? Sin is an issue. Such an issue, he came to die for it. But dealing with it is his, not ours. We don't need to treat people like that. Wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger. I'll come back to the cloth part in a minute because it's fascinating. But a manger was simply just a food trough, but it too was not made out of wood. It would have been carved out of stone. I'll show you one here in a minute. Wood was scarce. You read about Solomon. They literally imported the cedars of Lebanon in some of his writings. They didn't have a lot of trees. In all likelihood, the manger was actually in a cave. So we have the angel comes to the shepherds, and they were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. They literally lived out in the fields. And how this happens is mind-boggling. And once again, it kind of pokes at religion. You think of Abraham, Moses, David, and countless others. They were what? They were shepherds. Yet by this time in Israel, religious piety had risen itself where they looked down at shepherds. They were not allowed in towns. They could not vote. They were shunned upon. They were treated horribly. And these guys literally lived in the field. They were so dedicated and faithful to what they were doing. Well, what were they doing? Well, Bethlehem is only 4 or 5 miles, I believe, from Jerusalem. And in all probability, what they were doing is they were shepherding what we call sacrificial lambs. And what God did is he gave us what I like to call a talk picture. So when I was a missionary, we're always coming up with illustrations. And in this, we lived in Papua New Guinea and in the world. And one of the words in their language basically is like this. When you have a story, when you have something, it's a talk picture. It's a talking picture. And the Jewish sacrificial system was exactly that. So they would raise these lambs up and they could take them into the temple and they had a priest there and they would lay their hands on the sheep and there was a symbolic transfer of guilt that occurred. So the guilt would transfer from the sinner to the sacrificial lamb and it then bled and died on their behalf. That doesn't get anybody into heaven. It's the faith. And God respects as we see and understand that faith. Faith is what makes us right in the eyes of God. So here these guards, just a few miles from Jerusalem, faithful men raising up these lambs. That's who God came to in the middle of the night. He didn't show up to figures you've probably heard of, King Herod or Pontius Pilate, the chief priest. There's so many places he could go. Instead, he births his son to a poor peasant couple, a contractor. And then the first people that he wants to know about this are outcasts or shepherds. And boy, maybe it's religious piety has clocked you upside the head. Maybe you've been hurt by the church. I get it. I have, and I've seen a lot of that. There comes a point when you realize, you know what? If you are offended by some of the snobbery and piety that's out there and hypocrisy, you just know this. He came to the outcasts. He came to those that had nothing other than simple faith. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before these guys, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. I want to talk a minute about this glory of the Lord. In the Old Testament, whenever there was a visible manifestation of the presence of God, especially in the concept of dwelling, when they dwelled together, our Jewish friends called that the Shekinah glory. Shekinah glory was any time God had shown himself, had manifested and dwelt with them. That was the Shekinah glory. Our Hebrew friends didn't do so well with their pious religion. They clobbered a lot of people, but when it came to God, he was not the least bit impressed. They were so disobedient and so bad, it got to a point where they actually sacrificed their own children to pagan gods, literally almost as if they were on something you'd see in a pizza oven. And he said, I'm out of here. And we read about it in Ezekiel chapter 10, verse 4. Then the glory of the Lord went up from the cherub to the threshold of the temple. And the temple was filled with the cloud and the court was filled with the brightness of the glory of the Lord. And you see it advance in kind of stages. And in Ezekiel 10:18, then the glory of the Lord departed from the threshold of the temple and stood over the cherubim. You get the idea. And then he left. And the glory of God had not been manifest in Israel for hundreds and hundreds of years. And then the Shekinah glory the visible manifestation of God. The glory of God appears in the middle of that field to these outcasts. That's what we're talking about. In fact, it's interesting that New Testament is written in Greek, not Hebrew. But our Greek friends, starting with Alexander the Great, did a little research on this. It's fascinating because they were pantheistic, pan meaning lots of gods. They had gods for everything and they loved to appease them. So the idea that a God and man would dwell together appealed to the Greeks, the Romans, like they love that concept. They loved it a lot. In John chapter 1, verse 14, I want to share with you something. John chapter 1, verse 14, it talks about the incarnation. It says the Word, which is Jesus. I mean, in John 1, 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He wasing from all eternity past. Wasing is a fancy way of saying he existed eternally with God. And then he moves down to verse 14, and he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. But the word there for dwelt is skenai. See, what happens is the reason they couldn't put Shekinah there is because the Greek language has no way to make the sh sound. So the word modified and became skenai. What John is trying to tell us is God had what they called the Shekinah glory, fire, smoke, different ways that he appeared to them, but now God and man dwell together and that is made possible because of Jesus Christ. That is the skenai, God and man dwelling together. Jesus Christ is now the visible manifestation of God in the flesh, and John captures that so well, pointing his audience back to the Old Testament and the Shekinah glory. Let's go back to our shepherds here. The angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. And to any of our visitors here or whatever, that I just want you to know all the people, that totally means you. He came for all the people. He's already shown us it doesn't matter your class, it doesn't matter anything. All the people, don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Now we're doing names. Let's look at that one real quick. Is Christ his name? It's actually not. We know him as Jesus. In Greek, it was Jesus. But going all the way back to Hebrew, it would have been Yeshua. Why we didn't translate it Joshua? Probably because there's too many of them. We don't want a lot of Jesus running around. Yeshua, Yahweh is salvation. And Christ is a translation of the Hebrew word Meshiach, or we would call him the Messiah. That's who he was. He's born for a Savior who is Messiah, the Lord. Lord is used there to describe God. He is the Messiah, God. And then he comes on and he says, this angel, he says, this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Now, the word there, sign, doesn't require a miracle or anything, but if you study that word out, it is there's something unusual about it when you use that word. There's going to be a sign, something out of the ordinary. Actually, two things. There's going to be two things out of the ordinary. The first one is you find babies wrapped in cloths. Now, like I said, I was a missionary, and even over there, they'd have a baby. They would let it lay on the jungle floor for a number of hours, and it's really sad. But eventually, at some point, I think every culture around the world wraps their babies. So what's so unusual about this? I have this quote from Dr. Arnold Fruchtenbaum. He says this, the first clue was that the baby was wrapped in swaddling cloths. This is not unusual because all babies are wrapped in baby cloths. The word used here means burial cloths. The babe was wrapped in burial cloth, pointing out that he came for the purpose of dying for sins. The second was that he would be lying in a manger, a feeding trough. See, what they did is they didn't build, just as I mentioned with the guest room, they wouldn't have built and used wood to make barns or anything like that. They would take their animals in the cold of night into caves. But amongst these caves that the shepherds would use, they would also use as essentially as a morgue. See, when someone passed away, to follow the Jewish laws, they did not want to touch a corpse. So the first thing they would do is take a funeral procession out to these caves where they had carved into the caves these shelves, and on these shelves were those claws. So stand back and catch this for a moment. He shows up. No, we're not letting you and your floozy wife in. You guys aren't even married yet. Look at her. We're not letting her in. She's not welcome here. He's looking around and he's like, he goes to the cave and she's like, it's time. It's time. She gives birth to this baby and poor Joseph's sitting there going, didn't plan so good on this one. He looks over on the shelf and he grabs hold of a death cloth and wraps the baby. Jesus Christ came for two reasons. Three reasons. Okay, four, five. A couple important reasons to point out. When he came to offer the promised kingdom to our Jewish friends, and they rejected it, that kingdom will come. We are waiting for the return of Jesus Christ, and as we said in the text and in the song, he will sit on the throne of David. He came to offer them the kingdom they rejected, and he came to die for sins. And he came to live that life that we could look at and go, you know what? He gets me. He understands my pain, my loss, everything that we go through. He understands. And he loves every bit of us, every one of us, and every bit of who we are immensely, beyond measure. In fact, I brought a couple pictures here. This one is outside of Bethlehem. I think I saw that same manger, but I didn't take the picture. That's what it would look like. Probably some hay in there, wrapped in death cloths and lying in a manger. This came from a movie that was out years ago, but it captures the cave better than most traditional wooden structures do. There's the shepherds that come in and they're absolutely blown away what they see and what they find. When the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherd began saying to one another, let's go straight to Bethlehem then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has been made known to us. So they came in a hurry and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. When they'd seen this, they made known the statement which had been told them about the child. All who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. The shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as had been told them. The first recognition and worship of Jesus Christ was by these outcast shepherds. The first Gentile worship, a little bit late, but they're part of our story, is the Magi. And we covered that a couple weeks ago, so I won't spend a lot of time on it. But these Magi responded to his radiance, his glory. I'm going to suggest to you, they also saw the Shekinah glory. If they would have seen a real star, it would have destroyed this planet long before it was close enough. So we want to take the scriptures absolutely literally, but there's times when we go, wait a minute, is there an explanation for this? Yes, there is. They saw his radiance. Any ladies in here hoping to get a diamond tomorrow for Christmas? No, don't raise your hands, because the guys are going to be like, well, I don't want to burst a bubble, enjoy your diamond. But the word diamond and the word demon come from the same idea. In the same way that the word star and the word radiance come from the same idea, the same root word. What did those Magi see? They too saw his radiance. They too saw the Shekinah glory. And yet they took off and they went to Jerusalem. They didn't know about Bethlehem because they didn't have access to that prophecy. They had access from one of their own who was hired to curse the Jews way back in the book in the Old Testament. And every time he went to curse the Jewish people, he ended up speaking about Jesus. So they had a concept of this coming king. And then our Jewish friends in exile, Daniel's there. And Daniel wrote a timeline of when the Messiah would come. Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 to 27. And it's the craziest thing until you understand our God. There is tiny little sections of scripture that were written in Aramaic, which would have been the language of these guys. They were from modern day Iraq. It was written a timeline in their language. And of course, the prophet Daniel spoke extensively about the coming Messiah. God had left a trail of knowledge for them, and they saw his radiance, and it all clicked. So they got together gold and frankincense and myrrh, and off they went. They were a little late to the dance. That's why Herod ordered all the children 2 years and under to be slaughtered in conjunction with the timeline given by the Magi. The point in that is, when I say for all people, I mean all people. Iraqis, doesn't care to matter to him. Those are titles we put on people. He's for all the people. Jewish, Gentile, it doesn't matter. What is the gift? What is the gift this Christmas that we want to focus on? It's best understood right here. And I want to include verse 14, because see, here's what happens so many times as we go through the scriptures. Like, we read just John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gives his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. But we kind of sit back and we're like, really? I mean, is that it? I don't get it. So what Jesus did is he gave them a talk picture. He gave them a talking picture that he had used in the Old Testament. And the talk picture basically went like this. They were complaining and griping about life. And we do that too once in a while. And so God judged them. And he sent serpents, and the serpents were biting them, and they were dying. And then they finally basically called out to Moses and called out to God for mercy. And God said, make a bronze serpent. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. So they would hold up the serpent. And what was their responsibility? In a sense, if we understand the narrative, if we understand why do we do the things I do. I found myself the other day, Merry Christmas from me. Drives me nuts, all the cars that do the illegal U-turn in front of Costco, because they get in my way when I'm leaving work. I just laid on the horn and let this lady have it for blocking traffic like the jerk that I was in the moment. In other words, I could tell you a lot worse, but it's... Do you ever sit back and go, why are people just jerks sometimes? Why do we do the things that we do? Why do we need him to come? Because we're sinners. And we absolutely cannot fix ourselves. That's why Jesus told the priest, this is who he's talking to here, a priest, you must be born again. We can't fix the old. It's blown out. It's shot. It's no good. It is what it is. I want to make something new. You will be a new creation when you trust my son. I will work through that new created being in you. He will engage your mind, emotions. He will engage your soul and your spirit, and you will be mine then. And then he continues in it. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Just like that serpent went up, when that cross was raised up, and God, very God himself, was on that cross, there was a transfer of guilt that occurred, just like there was from the sinner to the sacrificial lamb. When you look at Christ crucified for your sins, and you believe that, God says, I got you now. He transfers your guilt onto him. And he died your death. He died your death. Your responsibility, not to get religious, obnoxious, but to look to that cross and him on that cross and believe. Closest synonym to belief is trust. You are trusting what God has said, and you receive the gift. And so I just want to encourage anyone. We're gonna have the singers, the band, come back up here and sing and call it an evening. We wanted to have a little bit of a shorter service tonight, but as they do, as we sing that holy night, if you have never, in your moment, said that cross, that Savior, that's him. He died for me, and then of course the resurrection proves that he wasn't lying about anything, and that his Father was satisfied. If you've never in your own mind just said, yes, I believe, I would really encourage you to think that through. And of course, if there's anything that I can do or anybody else here to help maybe connect a few more dots for you, we would love to do that. I want to wish you all a very Merry Christmas, and Let's really enjoy this last song, and then we'll see you all here next week. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for the talking pictures of what it's like to believe, to simply come realize we can't cure ourselves, we can't heal ourselves. And in a sense, we too have been bitten by the serpent who is Satan, and we got a problem. And you responded to that problem in grace and love, giving us your Son to be our Savior. And this Christmas, we just bow before you, we worship you, we thank you, and we love you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Divine, oh, my.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the birth of you. And I just bless everybody in this building, Lord, as they go and spend time with their families this evening and for tomorrow, and that they share the story of your birth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.